Thank you, friends from all over the country, and I am very happy that you all came here to see me growing old. I just crossed 85 years, and I'm very glad to tell you, to share with you, that out of 85 years plus of my life, 75 years plus of that period has been in the association of a perfect living master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh. That has shaped this life and has made me quite different from what I would have been otherwise. The fact that one person can affect another person to that extent is a miracle and worth seeing. And I have come to this conclusion after 75 years of experience that there is no friendship, there is no relationship that is equal to a relationship with a perfect living master. All other relationships are conditional in this world, but the relationship with a perfect living master is the only one I have found which is totally unconditional. A perfect living master is a friend who loves you if you love him, who loves you if you don't love him. He loves you if you hate him. He loves you if you kill him. That kind of unconditional love I've not seen amongst people of this planet. I traveled all around the world, and I find that we are all being dictated by our own minds, and we've totally forgotten who we are. We begun to believe that because we can think, therefore we are the thinking self. The thinking self is not the self. The thinking machine is a mind. It's just a machine. It's an accessory. It's been placed into us through biological brain, and that functions like a computer. No matter how efficient a computer may be, it can never become yourself. And yet we are all thinking that our minds are ourself, and the minds are dictating to us what we should do. The minds are arguing with us. The minds are creating doubt. The minds are creating fear and messing up our whole life. If we were able to recognize this simple fact that we are not the mind, but we are the spirit of consciousness that is empowering the mind, that is making the mind work, that we are that power of consciousness that makes the mind work, makes the senses work, make the body work. If we just recognize these are tools given to us to be in this experience of this physical world, these are just tools given to us. The mind, the senses, and this physical body are merely tools. They are not ourselves. They all disappear in time. None of them is immortal. They all have a lifespan. The physical body has the least lifespan. You hardly live up to 80, 90, 100 years. Some may live a little longer, some live less. It's a very short term in terms of the cosmic infinity of time around us. Even planets, even some trees, even some animals live longer than that. So this human body is not a very permanent thing we have, yet we mistake it for ourselves. The name given to our human body we think is our name. We think it is our own self. It is just a cover. It's like a jacket you are wearing. It's like a clothing, piece of clothing. No more than that. Just like we discard clothing if they are old, we change clothes, we change bodies. In the same way, how can we call our body as ourself? The sensory perceptions are arising from another inner body. We can call it the astral body, the sensory body, the subtle body, the imaginative body. You can give it many names. It is still a body, it's just a cover. It is a cover used to create sense perceptions, to create an experience of this world. It is not ourself. The mind is a thinking machine. It rationalizes, it thinks, it puts things together, and allows us to communicate with ourselves and with others. It introduces language, spoken language, written language. But that's it. It is just a machine, just a cover, another body. We call it the causal body because it causes all experiences to happen. Therefore, it's a very fundamental body. The sensory body outlives the physical body several times over. We may not know it, but through meditational experiences, through discovering who you are, you can find out that if you are not this physical body, then who are you? Have you lived before? Did you have past lives? Are you going to have future lives? This can be verified and checked up by us through the process of recall of memory. The memory is stored in the mind. The mind is much longer in duration in life than the physical body or even the sensory body. And the mind stores all the information that you need to find out. You want to find out if you ever lived before, just go into the memory bank in your own mind. It will reveal to you your past lives. Therefore, when we look at these three things, the physical body and the sensory systems that are the astral body and the thinking machine that is our mind, which is the causal body, these are three bodies which are covering our soul, our spirit, our consciousness. Our consciousness alone is immortal. Our consciousness alone is our reality. Our consciousness is alone our self. All others are just covers upon it. By misidentification with the covers and believing them to be ourself, we have got into all the mess that we've got into. Just by finding out and realizing that we are none of these covers, but we are the spirit and we are the consciousness, all the mess that we created around us can disappear. It's a very simple process. The spiritual journey we talk of is not traveling anywhere. We don't go anywhere. We just find out who we are. A discovery of the self is a perfect spiritual journey. And the discovery takes place within ourselves. There is nothing outside of ourselves. If we want to find who we are, we must go within ourselves. But instead of going within to see who we are going out searching for who we are. We are asking others who we are. We are looking into libraries, we are looking into books, looking into scriptures, looking into religion to find out who we are. Whereas the one who is trying to search who we are is sitting inside us, and that is ourself. So instead of withdrawing ourselves to where we belong and finding out that these things that we thought were the self, our physical body and the sensory systems and the mind that thinks and negotiates and speaks and writes and communicates, that these were merely covers upon ourself, that ourself lies within these things. By discovering that, we reach the ultimate spiritual goal of finding out who we are. When you find out who you are, you also find out why you have these covers. You also find out why you are here. You find out why you created this whole show. And you find out the whole show is created from within, not from outside. We worship God as if God sits somewhere outside, without realizing that if God is part of us and we are part of God, it must exist where our consciousness exists. If our consciousness lies within this body, within this mind, within the sensory system, God must lie there too. How can you separate God, with whom we have never been separated, and place him somewhere outside? So when I see people looking somewhere else, we are worshiping God, folding their hands, I start looking also, where is he? Hiding somewhere? How could he be hiding anywhere? He has never been separated from us. If he got separated even for a second, we would not exist. How can God be total and perfect if anything can be separated from it? If any one of us, if any soul can be separated from God, how can it be God anymore? Therefore, nothing is ever separated from God. And if nothing is ever separated, then God must be where we are, our true self is. That means within ourselves. Therefore, those who try to find God somewhere, they must find God within themselves. Because God resides nowhere else except within one's own consciousness and within one's own self. But we are so far removed by our own unawareness of who we are. We have created a distance between God and ourselves. We have created a distance between ourselves and our covers just by believing that the outer form that we have, the outer appearance we have of our physical body is ourself. And that's the biggest blunder we could have made. We've made a big blunder. Fortunately, there are people who can tell you it's a blunder, and they can help you to correct it. We all make mistakes, but we can correct the mistakes. If we have made a mistake in believing that our Creator is outside somewhere, and if we have made a mistake in believing that this body of ours is ourself, it can be corrected. Only somebody who knows the truth can come and tell us that this is not yourself. Yourself lies inside these covers. And it's not difficult to know that. It's not difficult to find out who you are. Indeed, it's the simplest of things to find out who you are. There's nothing simpler. There is no struggle involved. There is no journey to be made. There are no books to be read. There's no literature required. All you have to do is to withdraw your attention from outside to inside. It's as simple as that. If you can place your attention within yourself, gradually you'll find out that the covers that you thought were yourself, they are merely covers, and you can become unaware of them. It's only attention that makes us aware of anything. When we look at the world, we look at different things. How do we know them? How do we know they exist? Just by the process of picking up those impressions through our attention. Wherever we place our attention, that becomes a reality for us. So we are using our attention and moving it around, and wherever we put our attention, that particular experience becomes a reality for us. If that is as simple as that, could we not put our attention back on our own consciousness and find out who we are? Indeed, we can. And that's exactly the process that these perfect living masters, who have actually discovered themselves, have come and told us. They have come all the time. They have come again and again in this world. They have come for those who seek to know who they are. They come for the seekers. They don't come for themselves. And since they are always seekers everywhere who are seeking to find out who they are, these perfect living masters who are human beings like us, they look like us, they live like us, they eat like us, they behave like us, and yet the only difference between them and us is that they know who they are, and they can teach us how to know how we are, who we are. That is why these teachers come and tell us that the process of discovery of the self is not a difficult one. It's a very simple one. It is, instead of scattering your attention all over the world, scattering your attention to all material things around you, put your attention on yourself within. Gradually, you'll find that you can collect again all the scattered attention and bring it within the consciousness as you perceive it, as you realize it. You know, when we are in the body, in a wakeful state, like we all are in this conference room at this time, we know that we are conscious because we open our eyes, we can hear with our ears, we can know that we are conscious and we are aware of what's going on around us. Where is this consciousness coming from? Where are we aware of? Just contemplate. Just introspect for a moment. Where are we conscious from? It's obviously not from anywhere outside. It's coming from inside, this body. Not only that, it's not only coming from the body. You can also look at the body. As you can see, it's not coming from your hands. It's not coming from your feet. It's not even coming from your torso. It's coming from somewhere in your head. And if you introspect even a little more, and just think about it a little more, you can find out that your attention is flowing and consciousness is active because you are seeing through the eyes and you have located the level of your consciousness. If it was just one single point, it is somewhere behind the eyes. It doesn't take long to realize that, that we are operating as conscious beings by being conscious from somewhere in the head behind the eyes. Having located ourselves to that extent that we know where consciousness is operating from, the task becomes very simple. Now put your attention there, from where it is flowing out. instead of focusing attention on things outside, instead of focusing attention on your body, instead of focusing attention on the senses, instead of focusing attention on thoughts, focus your attention where the attention is flowing out from, where the attention is making the body work, where the attention is picking up all the experiences around, where the attention is using the consciousness to think. Put your attention exactly where it's flowing out from. It looks simple. It may not be easy. It is not easy because we have made it difficult. How did we make it difficult? Because all our life, we think that the only way to use attention is to focus it outside somewhere. We have never practiced withdrawing attention to itself. So therefore, it looks like a new thing. Actually, it's not very new, because you are not going to go anywhere, you are going to go back where you are. Therefore, to withdraw your attention to where it belongs, from where it is flowing, is the art of self-discovery, and it's the true spiritual path. Once you do that, even partially, you'll see results which will be amazing. It will give you a knowledge of the reality or unreality of this creation. It will give you knowledge how all things are being created around you. It will give you knowledge how long you have been here in this experience. It will give you knowledge whether you had other forms of life in which you had different experiences. Even partial journey toward your own self gives you all this information. And it is not based upon some astrologer or somebody telling you. It's based upon your own introspection. It's based upon your own experience. Therefore, the best way to celebrate a holiday, in my opinion, is to celebrate where you actually belong. That means in your true home. Your true home is where you belong, and not in a place that you have created only for an adventure, for an experience. This world we have created only for an adventure. It's a place for experience. We wanted experience because consciousness desires to be conscious. It has to be conscious of something. Therefore, it creates experiences. Every experience it creates a new world for itself. And we have no idea that there are so many worlds already created within us. We just shut them out, and we open out only a small world, and we see outside, and we think this is all reality here. There's no other reality. We question everything that really belongs to us, and we begin to believe in things that have just been created as an experience. We rely far more on the experience than on the experiencer. We don't even want to know who the experiencer is. Who is actually experiencing? Which consciousness is having all the experience? We don't go into that. Now, I am glad that we are here to celebrate, but I wanted to share that true celebration can be done every day. The saints and mystics celebrate Christmas every day. They celebrate all the festivals every day. They go into an enlightened area, not only enlightened in the sense of knowledge, but enlightened in the sense of the lights that we put out. We put out little bulbs and little candles, and we think that is light. You want to see light? Go within yourself. You'll see physical light of an intensity you could never even imagine. You could put 1,000 suns that you see outside, which you can't even face with these physical eyes, and you can see them within yourself. They all exist right now in all of us. There's so much physical light. There's so much beautiful melody and music and rhythm inside us. You can never recreate it outside. We are following little copies of these things, and we just go by little imitations, and we think that is the reality. We think meditation is listening to a recorded music that we made ourselves. What about the unending music that's lying inside us? There's a music in us that has never been created by us. Indeed, it has no beginning. It has no end. It's part of consciousness. It's immortal. The music within us, the music within consciousness, is immortal as the soul itself. Yet we run outside to listen to music, and we think that's such a nice music that we are going into a state of meditation. How can you go into a state of meditation when something is drawing you out into something that's temporary? I have not heard any music that's permanent in this world. It all starts and ends. But the music that is inside us is everlasting and never ends. Therefore, the best way to celebrate is to put up the lights that already exist, to enjoy the lights, enjoy the sounds, enjoy the music that lies inside. All the mystics, they enjoy every day, they enjoy every night, they celebrate their holiday every day. We celebrate it so rarely, once or twice a year, and we say this is a great celebration. Of course, it's nice while we are ignorant to celebrate this also. But if we have some knowledge, then we should not miss the other celebration, which is much more fascinating, much more blissful, much more real, much more immortal and permanent. So that is all lying within us. The spiritual path is not to abandon the world. It is not to run away from anything. Some people think that you have to run away from this world to become spiritual. That's totally false. People have run away into the forest. They gone into the caves. I come from a country where I visited those caves, where people, monks are sitting and meditating for long periods. But their desires have not finished there. Supposing I like pizza, which I'm sure is going to come in a little while again as a party food today. I love pizza and I run into a forest and go into a cave that I am running away from pizza. I can assure you my mind will run more after pizza in the cave than it does here. Because here I can get it, there I can't get it. What you can't get, you desire even more. Desires and attachments don't go away by running away into forests and going into caves and going into monasteries and going to hidden places. The only place where you are really hidden is your own body. And that's where you have to go in. And you don't have to leave any place. You don't have to leave anything in order to go in there. To go to the right cave, go into the cave that lies behind your eyes. That's the proper cave to enter for proper meditation. Don't have to go anywhere else. So we run to other places thinking that we are able to detach ourselves. I have never seen even a single person, including myself, who could run away from a thing and say, we are detached. I could never find a person who could say, I want to be detached from this, therefore I am detached. People say, I want to be detached from this. The more they say, the more attached they get. Because the same thought keeps on coming again and again. Detachment cannot be practiced. There is no such thing as practice of detachment. If you want to withdraw your attention from here, you can't practice detachment to go somewhere else. Because detachment, the more you try to be detached, the more it attaches you because of the power of desire and bonding with things that we are attached to. Once we get attached to something, that thought keeps on crawling in us all the time. And if you don't believe how much we are attached to things, try meditation, all the attachments come up in front of you. Try just to withdraw your attention to yourself and you see how many things are pulling you out because of those attachments. Therefore, detachment is never practiced. What causes detachment to happen is a higher attachment. If you are attached to something more than you are attached to others, automatically you get detached from the others. Therefore, it's a new attachment that can create the experience of detachment. It is not that you can practice detachment by itself. Therefore, if you find something far more attractive within yourself in meditation, it will automatically detach you from the things outside. When you find that the lights inside, the glistening bright holiday lights inside, are far more attractive than any lights you have seen outside, you automatically get more attached to them, and detachment with the outside light becomes automatic. So it's attachment that will cause detachment and not that practice of detachment will make you detached. So that is why it's necessary to find something more attractive, find something better than you are attached to. And there is nothing better than finding out the reality within yourself. The experiences that lie within ourselves in meditation are so wonderful, so attractive, that nothing outside can ever beat them. You can try them out. This is not a theoretical exercise I'm doing. I am telling you what is practically possible for each one of us. It is not a man-made thing. Spirituality is made by the Creator along with us. Every time we have a human body, we have a human mind, We have the human capability of finding the truth within ourselves. The spiritual path has been laid out in advance. We don't have to find it and make it. It's there. We just have to discover it. It's not a new creation. Therefore, when we find the spiritual path, we really celebrate. I don't mind people who are still struggling in this world and are feeling the pressures around them to celebrate. They can celebrate the holidays. They celebrate Christmas. They celebrate the Jewish holidays. They celebrate all other holidays. They celebrate Diwali in India, the Festival of Lights. All those festivities are all right, but they are nothing compared to the festivities inside. Okay, enjoy outside if you can, but I find great pressures. Do you know the rate of suicides is the highest during the holidays in this country? Because people are lonely in the holidays. They don't have somebody to enjoy the holiday with. What kind of holiday season is this? Do you know people are under pressure? Oh, we have to buy presents. We don't have enough funds. Economy is bad. And yet we have to give the presents to all. We are under great strain and pressure. What are you doing? We are celebrating a holiday. Is this a celebration of holiday? If you could celebrate a holiday with the same joy and bliss that you could celebrate within yourself, I would say, okay, for a temporary purpose, temporarily enjoy the holidays here also. But if these holidays are such a pressure and a strain upon you, where is the holiday? Holiday should be relaxing. People want to enjoy their holidays, but every holiday they make very strained. People say, we know how to make a good holiday. And I said, just give me also an idea, because I have not seen such great holidays outside as I see inside. So tell me some nice holidays outside. Oh, we should go to a nice beach in nice weather, and Palm Beach. We should go to some beaches and relax there. Okay, did you go there? We did. We missed the flight. We had so much trouble there on the way with the plane. Then we had a hotel reservation was cancelled. All our holiday was spoilt. What about the beach? They forgot about the beach. What kind of holidays are these? I mean, we are under stress and strain into have a holiday, and we come back sometimes more strained. And mostly we come up with bigger bellies. What happened? Oh, we were on a diet, but you know, it was a holiday. So we had to break our diets, and now we have to fast for several days to get back into shape. What kind of holiday is that? So if you look at the way we celebrate holidays, it makes us think, what are we doing? Why can't we enjoy some real holidays? Why can't we really relax? The best way to relax that I have discovered is through meditation. There is no relaxation greater than good meditation. And I specifically say good meditation because we can make hard meditation also. We can make difficult meditation. When we struggle to meditate, it becomes difficult meditation. We have a tendency to struggle because we always struggle in life. Everything we want to get in life, we have to struggle for it, work for it, actively. Be very active. If I tell people the way to get good meditation is not to struggle at all, that good meditation is totally effortless. If you put effort, it becomes bad meditation. Say, how is it possible? Our mind has not been trained to do that. Our mind has been trained always to put an effort. We are so used to effort that even the perfect living masters had to give in and say, okay, start with your effort. Soon you'll find out effort leads you nowhere. And then you start relaxing and say, there is something else that causes good meditation. What is that? What is that unseen thing, indescribable thing that turns a struggling meditation with so much effort into an effortless meditation? And people want to use different words, but most of them say it must be grace of some kind. It must be Lord's grace. It must be Master's grace. That is true. The truth is that you cannot meditate without Master's grace. The mind will not let you do it. The truth is that all the time when you make effort, you could not even make the effort without that grace. The truth is that the grace is the whole thing. for effortless meditation. If we recognize this, which takes time because we are so used to effort with our mind, that we do not believe that anything can happen without effort. So we have to put in effort, and we put in a lot of effort. We get frustrated with that effort, till we discover that was not the way, there is something else going on. Now there is a little catch here. It's called catch 22, 21, I don't know, there's a number, some catch there. And the catch is that in order to grasp the fact that there is a thing called grace, it needs another element called faith. That you, if you don't have faith, you don't believe in grace. Effort you believe in, you see it. Your mind is making the effort, your body is making the effort, you can see it, you can experience it, it's a reality for you. Grace, is it there or not? Is it coming or not? It's accompanied with doubt. And doubt, well, doubt will always kill the effort and the grace because you don't know what's happening. So there is a new element called faith. And faith is a very strong element for accepting that grace is working. And if we have no faith, then we don't even accept that there is grace. We want to say, I want grace. I am trying hard to get grace. One friend of mine wrote a letter to me. He says, it has taken me years to discover that effort means nothing, that you have to depend on grace. Now I am trying very hard to get grace. What kind of effortless grace is that? Instead of shifting his effort into bodily meditation, he is now shifting his effort into finding grace. You don't find grace, you accept it. This whole art of faith, recognition of grace, and acceptance is a whole new chapter of life. It is not the same that we live every day with our minds, that you have to make an effort, you have to strive hard, without struggle, nothing will come to you. We have been trained like that, we grow up like that, and we think the same thing applies to the spiritual path. It doesn't. What applies to spiritual path is faith, acceptance, and the grace flowing. Grace is always flowing. What is stopping us from taking advantage of the grace and going into effortless meditation? Again, it's only our own attention. Our attention is not directed towards the grace. Attention is like a cup. You can keep the cup straight or you can put it upside down. Rain, grace falls like rain, and raining all the time. Grace is flowing like that. How much your cup catches, it depends on the angle of your cup. You keep your cup upside down, no rain falls into that cup. No matter how strong the showers are. If you turn your cup slightly, a few drops can go in. Sometimes they fall out, sometimes they come in. It's only when the cup is upright toward the rain, it receives and accepts and gets filled up in no time. It's like that. Grace flows like that. And the grace of the Lord is flowing. We don't recognize it. So that is why when we come to the process of discovering that effort does not work, which because of our histories, because of the background in which we have lived, takes time to get frustrated with effort and to get disappointed with effort and say, I tried so hard, it didn't work. There must be something else in it. And then we begin to see that there is something else in it, actually. And then we begin to accept, and faith grows. Faith does not grow at once, because faith is of two kinds. One is called blind faith, and one is called living faith. The blind faith is when you accept somebody's word and say that is true. No experience of yours, no verification, no proof, no conviction, but you just want to believe. You want to believe for the sake of believing. Religion has provided a lot of that stuff. Blind faith. Religion says this is it, and you believe it. You grow up with it. From childhood, you got indoctrinated with it. That just because the religion has said this is the truth, this is the truth. No verification. That's blind faith. If somebody says God is sitting up in a heaven in this direction, you believe it. God will always sit in that direction in heaven. You'll never see that God. Never. because it's blind faith. There's nothing growing in it. There's no life in it. On the other hand, living faith is that which grows with you on a daily basis like a living organism. Living faith is, I do believe there's something strange has happened by way of a coincidence. This looks too strange that it should happen at this time. Bring little faith. Now a miracle has happened today for me. Little more faith. Today more miracles have happened. What is miracle? Miracle is something happening that you didn't expect it to happen and it pleases you. And you say, yeah, this is what I wanted. How could it have happened? There is something else, some power working that's giving me these things. And your faith builds up. That kind of faith is built step by step, degree by degree, event by event. That's living faith. And it is that faith which grows, and up to a certain point it grows, and then you begin to have acceptance. And acceptance then immediately is able to recognize the grace that is flowing, and your meditation becomes effortless. So effortless meditation is connected with living faith, and it's connected with an experience of regular miracles. Now I must tell you, I just mentioned the word coincidence. Coincidence is not an accident. Coincidence is a message to us. It's a message, it's a miraculous event actually. A coincidence that answers a question is even more miraculous. If you have a question in your mind, you're driving your car and see an advertisement on a signboard on the road, and one part of the sentence of that ad, nothing to do with that ad, answer the question you had in your mind, what kind of coincidence is that? Where are you getting the answer from? If you have a question in your mind and you accidentally open a book and the first sentence on the book is an answer relevant to your question, what kind of accident is that? What kind of coincidence is that? These are events that are being created to prove to us that our faculty of reason is not the only faculty to employ in understanding things, that we have another faculty too. And that faculty is called intuition. Intuitive faculty is different from reason. Reason is being employed by our mind. Intuition is employed directly by our consciousness and our soul. Mind does not participate in the intuitive process. Mind is fully occupied with the reasoning process, the logical process, putting things in a way that it makes sense to us. That's logic, that is mind. Intuitively knowing something, I know it, but I can't say how I know it. That's intuition. A gut feeling is intuition. Intuition and reason both are operating in us. We rely all the time more on reason and less on intuition. We try to even cancel out the information we get by intuition, by reasoning out of it. So therefore, reason becomes supreme in our life. In order to help us to use our intuition effectively, we find these coincidences happening outside. And you will notice that when you have an intuitive feeling, something coincidental happens outside to confirm the same intuitive feeling. So there are two languages being spoken by the soul. The language of intuitive knowledge inside and the language of a coincidental happening outside. And they both correspond with each other. And both of them build your faith. Once you see these things happen, they build faith. I have watched for several decades now my friends who have come on the spiritual path. The more they have practiced meditation, the more coincidences are happening in their life. Were they not happening before? We don't know. Maybe they were happening and they never noticed it. And now they're noticing it. But the fact that more intuitive knowledge comes to them and more coincidences happen outside shows it's a language that is conveying to us something, that rely more on yourself and less on your mind. Rely more on the real immortal being that you are, the consciousness, and less on a temporary accessory given to you called a reasoning mind. It's a big lesson. And if we have just learned that lesson, it changes our life. I can tell you from experience that any one of these little steps changes your life. You don't have to go all the way in order to say my life is changed. You go a few steps inside. Just discover, just your inner self beyond this physical body, it changes. When you discover more, it's even better. the perfect living masters, who are always very few in this universe, always, they have been very few in number, because they come at the last stage of a seeker's seeking. When we seek, we do not know anything about our reality. We have no idea what exists beyond time and space. We don't know anything that exists beyond our reasoning and our logic. So therefore, we have to cross a certain threshold of knowledge through various teachers, through various disciplines, and we go up to a point only when we feel we want to go beyond what we know. We want to go beyond our mind. We want to go to the ultimate reality. When the seeking becomes intense at that level, you automatically run into a perfect living master. You can't find one. Because unlike any other teacher, a perfect living master is just like us, lives like us. You can't recognize him. Therefore, how would you know? Nobody has ever been able to find a perfect living master. They've always been, at the right time, been found by a perfect living master. How? By coincidence. Again, the same thing. By coincidence, they run into a being, a person like them, like a friend. Now, a perfect living master could be a very different kind of being to distinguishing from us. What would happen if a person is totally different and we say that's a perfect living master? He could be worshipped, could be admired, adored, could not be made a friend. No way. We want a friend who's like us, who shares our life, who shares our troubles, and shares the life that we are leading. A friend at our level. You can't have friendship with somebody who's flying in the sky. You can only have friendship with a person who's down on the earth, like us. If a perfectly living master is recognized by flying in the sky, and one comes into this hall right now and flies up into the sky, and we all look at him, what will happen? Some of you will swoon to see a man. Some will say, no, we know there's some string attached somewhere. Let's see what kind of trick is this. And some of you will be admiring, this must be real. But nobody will have a feeling of friendship for that being. If by chance he falls down, then many of them will rush and say, are you hurt? Are you all right? And he can be a friend at that time. Don't forget, friendship is at the level at which we are. True friendship does not exist anywhere except where we are. And that is why these perfect living masters choose not to come in any other form except the form in which we are. Throughout history, they come in the same form. They come with the same culture. They come with the same language, which the seekers and the disciples have been speaking and have been living. So that is why we can't find these. But when our seeking becomes strong, and we have reached a point when we want to go to the ultimate reality, we have recognized that the mind has its limitations. The mind does not take us where we want to go. The mind restricts us. The mind cannot function beyond time and space. The mind is confined to a universe over here in the three worlds. Then we want something beyond, to our true reality, to our true bliss, not something that we have to learn, unlearn. Then we get very happy and then we get disappointed. Not that kind of bliss. We want to have a bliss that is immortal, like ourselves, like our own spirit. At that time, when you seek that, definitely perfect living master comes into your life, no matter what corner of the world you are living in. You can't find one. He'll find you. Don't worry about it. If you are seeking in your heart, don't have to seek loudly. Don't have to shout for him. He can hear you inside. If he cannot hear you, he's not a perfect living master. If he does not know your inmost feelings, if he does not know who you are, if he does not know what you seek, he's not a perfect living master. A perfect living master, no matter how ordinary he looks, no matter how ordinary he lives, has this remarkable ability that his consciousness is not ordinary. His consciousness has already reached a state where we want to go. He's not talking from any literature, not talking from any books at all. He's talking from personal experience which he has, an experience that he's holding with him at the time when he's talking to us. It's a very different experience. Therefore, when we are ready, a perfect living master appears, and we are on the right track, because then a guide who has already been on a particular track can always take us right on the track. If we try to travel alone, we can get lost. We have questions nobody is there to answer. But if we have a guide continuously with us, then all questions are answered right on the way. On the way to the truth, on the way to our realization, we get all questions answered. Therefore, I strongly recommend those who have got this beautiful advantage of having been found by a perfect living master, rejoice. There is no greater holiday than that. There is no greater celebration than that, because you are on the right track. The beauty of acceptance by a perfect living master is that once a perfect living master accepts you through a simple process called initiation, if he initiates you, he takes full responsibility for you. He takes permanent responsibility for you, not temporary. He is not merely a teacher telling you how to do something. He's taken personal responsibility, and he will make sure that you reach the same spot, you reach the same awareness that he has. They say that there's a philosopher's stone which makes iron into gold. A perfect living master is not like that, that he makes your lives better. He makes you like himself. A philosopher's stone that changes iron into the philosopher's stone and not into gold. That you can yourself then change everybody else also. He makes you identical to himself. So that's a great opportunity, and I think that's the greatest celebration. And I would not really worry too much about struggling, about saying, I have to find something, I have to find the right books for this thing. I think the most important thing is just seek in your own heart. Seek for the truth. Ask the Lord, I have been waiting for you. I want to really have a holiday with you. I want to rejoice. This is going to be my greatest holiday. And ask for that rejoicing inside you. I want that bliss which is permanent, immortal, like you and I. I don't want the bliss that is temporary, like the covers of my body and my senses and mind. I want permanence, eternity, infinite. Once you ask for that, you will get a response. So I wish you all very happy holidays, and enjoy yourself, and happy 2012 also, New Year. We'll have a break for some food for the body. I've given you too much food, I think, for the spirit and for the mind. So now we have some food for the body, have a relaxing time, and I'll rejoin you and tell you a little few more stories later in the afternoon. Thank you.